Okay, now we are going to look at an order that most people are very, very familiar with, especially if you've ever walked outside. These are the Hymenoptera. Hymenoptera are commonly known as the bees, the ants, and the wasps. So everybody has seen these more than likely, especially if you live in one of these southern states like Texas. You have ants outside all the time. If you leave something out on your counter, sometimes ants come in. People freak out over bees and wasps. So most people are very familiar with these particular things or these particular insects in this order. So, breakdown of the term. Hymen means membrane. And pteron means wings. So these insects are characterized by these very membranous wings. Okay? They have two pairs of these wings, but the hind wings are pretty reduced. So these hind wings can be very, very small, and they are attached to the forewing so that when the insect flies, it uses both the hind wing and the forewing as one larger wing. If you get into studying Hymenoptera, there's all manner of terms and stuff for those the hooks that allow for that hind wing to be hooked to that forewing and how things move. But just know that they do have those hind wings, but they're usually very small. The adults are very easily recognized by a narrow junction between the abdomen and the thorax, at least in general. So you can see that here in most of these. Look at this wasp, little tiny quote unquote waist. Look at these ants here. Narrow junction, narrow junction. Okay, so even in these bumblebees or these big hairy bees, you can see this junction in between the abdomen and the thorax. Okay, so in general, you see that. So anytime you see an insect with a very narrow waist like that, it is likely a member of the Hymenoptera. Now, you will probably be thinking about all those Hymenoptera, and especially the ants that you see that do not have wings. So this is a portion of this order where certain individuals in the group will have wings and others won't. So there are winged ants. Usually we see winged ants when they are spreading their they have too big of a colony and they have to move. So then that colony will produce those wings. But because ants live underground, those wings become a liability. They don't need them all the time. So most of the workers, most of the soldiers, the queen, etc., do not have the wings unless they become reproductives and then they can move along. So they do have them somewhere in there. They haven't lost them totally. It's just you just mostly don't see them in general. Okay. Now, most of the species of Hymenoptera are very narrowly adapted to specific habitats or specific hosts. You can find them exploiting all manner of niches. This gives them a really big range of behavioral adaptation. You're going to find all kinds of Hymenopterans out there, from the very, very well-known honeybee to the lesser-known parasitoids of insects and animals. Now, this is the only order other than Isoptera, other than the termites, that have evolved a very complex social system. This social system involves the division of labor. So every organism in these colonies will have specific jobs. So there are several species of Hymenoptera that create colonies, and the members have specific tasks that they have to complete within that colony. So ants and bees especially have very highly evolved social behavior. So in these cases, the colony is formed by a queen who is the sexually mature adult. She lays her eggs, and these will hatch into workers. These workers are then responsible for everything within that colony, from maintaining the hive or nest to gathering food to caring for the young. Some of the eggs are going to hatch into soldiers. These will protect the hive from invaders. Others eventually might hatch into other reproductives or into males, which can then fertilize future queens. So it's just a division of labor. Everybody has their own specific job, and it's all mediated by like hormones and things. Now, different species of Hymenoptera feed on different things. You'll see them feeding on plants, so they'll be phytophagous. You'll see them be predatory, or they can be parasitic. There are some species that we call parasitoids. Now, you heard me say this word very quickly just a moment ago, but parasitoids are wasps or organisms that lay their eggs on a host, and the larvae will hatch out and feed on that host. When the insect turns into an adult, when that larvae turns into adult, they're no longer parasitic. So parasitoids are only parasitic in one part of their life cycle, usually that larval stage. So parasitoids just partially parasitic during the adult stage. They feed on things like nectar or their phytophagus or their predators or something of that nature. But they're parasitic in that one portion of the stage. So because of this, and some other things, some Hymenoptera are regarded as pests, but most are extremely beneficial. In their pestiferous form, they can cause extensive damage to plants, they can cause damage to landscaping, and they can cause damage to homes. The most well-known Hymenopteran pest is probably the ant. They create those large colonies. They might sting anyone who gets near them. Remember that it's the females that are stinging. They have the ovipositors. Many of you here in Texas have probably encountered fire ants in this area. This is one of those really annoying Hymenopteran pests. There are also other ants that are coming through that can completely strip down wiring, that can chew through a lot of things and cause a lot of problems. The beneficial aspects of Hymenoptera, however, outweigh the negative aspects. So Hymenoptera are natural enemies on other insect pests, or they can act as pollinators, or both. So we use many species of Hymenoptera to control other organisms, other phytophagous organisms, or other insect pests. So this picture here, this is a picture of a parasitic or a parasitoid wasp that is actually laying its eggs on a caterpillar. And this is what a caterpillar here looks like covered in parasitic wasp eggs or parasitoid eggs. And so you will sometimes see caterpillars like this out in your garden. That just means they're just about to be eaten from the inside out by wasp larvae. So this is a pretty common sight around here, these large green caterpillars covered in these white eggs. So these caterpillars cause extensive damage to crops. If you have a garden, you know this. Okay? Tobacco hornworm here, this will just eat through your garden like there's no tomorrow. Okay? These eggs on this caterpillar are going to hatch. The larvae are going to burrow their way into that caterpillar and feed on that caterpillar, that living caterpillar, from the inside out. So it'll eventually kill it. So the adults of these wasps, they don't sting. They're very tiny. They're completely harmless to other humans and other vertebrates. But we can release them into areas that have a lot of these caterpillars or a lot of other pests. And they will lay their eggs and cause a reduction in those pest species. The other major benefit of Hymenoptera is their ability to pollinate plants. I'm sure you are familiar with the honeybee, right? This is considered by many to be the most important insect on Earth. This is because of its extensive pollination abilities. The honeybee we most commonly see is the European honeybee, and its pollination activities have increased U.S. crop yields by over $15 billion per year. So this brings in a ridiculous amount of money for the U.S., for our cropping systems, for all of that, and it ups the yield of crops, meaning we can make more food. That's why they're considered one of the most important insects on Earth. They keep people from dying of starvation. But honeybees aren't the only Hymenopteran pollinators. Any one of these organisms that feed on nectar can act as pollinators. So most of the wasps, the bumblebees, the solitary bees, even some of the ants are considered pollinators. Now, Hymenoptera have some weird reproductive strategies. I mentioned a couple of these a couple weeks ago, but the females will develop from fertilized eggs. So if a Hymenopteran wants to produce female offspring, she goes out, she mates, she fertilizes those eggs, she has females. Males, on the other hand, develop from unfertilized eggs. Therefore, the females can control whether or not an egg is fertilized. Therefore, they can regulate the sex ratio of their offspring. So this means that most ant and bee colonies are made up of primarily female individuals. All of the workers, all of the soldiers, all of those are females. Males are usually only produced when the queen needs to fertilize her eggs. Okay, so the females are much more adapted. They're much more common in Hymenoptera than the males. Now, I could go on forever about Hymenoptera. These are fascinating insects. They have really, really complex social system. They have incredible behaviors. I just don't have time for that. I'm going to tell you some, you know, interesting stories about a few really quick. Then I'm going to show you a couple of videos that I like a lot. And then if you are interested in Hymenoptera, we do have a honeybee class here at Texas A&M. I highly recommend you take it. There's one that is an in-person class where you actually go out and get to work with the honeybees. There's another online class that you can also take, and you can learn all about this amazing, amazing group. Okay. So let's go just through a few interesting things. I've already told you about these parasoids here down at the bottom left, but let's go through this. This here. God damn it. Back. Okay, I've already told you about the parasoids down here at this bottom left. But let's go through a couple of these other interesting photos. This bright purple and blue Hymenopteran right here. Look how gorgeous that is. Those colors kill me all the time. That purple and blue Hymenopteran is called a cuckoo wasp. We have these around here. You can see them flying. They'll usually fly alone. We sometimes see them bright greens and golds and really crazy colors. They have the best colors, but they're pests. So these will invade the nests of wasps or bees. So they will kill the larvae, deposit their own eggs, and then the workers in, say, a honeybee nest will tend the eggs of the cuckoo wasp, feeding the young and caring for them. Awesome. Right, well, not awesome for the bees, but awesome because these things are shiny and pretty. Okay. This here is known as the honeypot ant. Okay, this is a South American species, and what this species does is it'll gather nectar, it'll gather other sugars, and it'll house that sugar in these living storehouses made out of the abdomens of certain worker bees. So certain workers will fill up those abdomens with the sugar liquid, and the abdomens become so big that they cannot leave their nest. So here you can see these sclerotized plates on the surface of that abdomen. This is just full of the sugar. This nectary sugar water in this abdominal region. Okay, so because these now basic refrigerators, right, will not or cannot leave the nest, they're going to grab onto the roof of the nest with their mandibles and just sort of hang there and just act like hanging refrigerators for the food. So this species of ant tends to live on the edges of deserts or on the edges of very arid habitats. This method of food storage is beneficial for saving food during the rainy season and then slowly giving it back to the colony during the dry season when flowers and when nectar just are not out and about. Right, this is the tarantula hawk. Oh, these ones are great. So the tarantula hawk are very, very common everywhere there are tarantulas. So we naturally have tarantula hawks here in this area. The hawks are very, very large. They often have metallic blue or purple bodies and these bright orange or red wings. So they're really spectacular to see. You'll see these hawks, these wasps, flying around just alone. They're searching for their main prey, which is the tarantula. Females will attack a spider, and she's going to sting the spider with her sclerotized ovipositor. The sting is placed just behind the tarantula's head. This is going to paralyze the tarantula, but it will not kill it. The female wasp is then going to drag the tarantula back to a nest site. This is usually out of the way and buried underneath the ground. So she's going to lay her eggs in the abdomen of the paralyzed spider and bury the spider so that the young wasp larvae are safe. The larvae are going to hatch out and they're going to consume that tarantula alive from the abdomen up. So this is a way to provide fresh food for those larvae. So by paralyzing this organism, she doesn't kill it outright. It stays alive long enough for the larvae to hatch and eat it. Now, one of the most notorious characteristics of Hymenoptera are their ability to sting. This is done through that sclerotized ovipositor. So all the bees, all the wasps, all the ants that sting are female. The males don't have ovipositors, therefore they do not have the ability to sting. Now, the stinger is used as protection or as a hunting mechanism, depending on the anatomy and the life history of these insects. Some insects or some Hymenoptera may only be able to sting once. Others can sting you over and over and over again. So this is a wasp. Wasps can sting you many, many times because their abdomens or their ovipositors are smooth. Watch this. She just plunges that in, takes it out, plunges it in again. Okay, so every time she stings you, she's going to be injecting venom, which can cause a severe reaction. So you can see the muscles of the abdomen pulsating here. That's that injection of this venom. Okay, and this is forcing that stinger in. But this is why wasps can be really awful. They can sting you again and again and again, and they will. They are jerks. These are honeybees, okay? So honeybees, on the other hand, have a very different anatomy in their stinger. Their stinger is barbed. So once it is forced into your flesh, it's really hard to remove again. When the bee flies away, that actually rips out her guts. It rips out these venom glands and these muscles. Okay? That distal portion of that abdomen. This means that the muscles are going to continue to contract. That's what's happening here. They're contracting and they're forcing more venom into your flesh even after the bee has flown away. That individual bee is going to die, but the amount of venom injected into a potential threat usually means that that colony is safe.
Hello there.
Hi.
I leant forward and presented my hands.
Oh, God.
Could I put these gloves on and keep my cool in front of the tribe?
Have mercy.
Oh, 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 oh. Obviously not.
Oh, 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 oh.
Jeez, with a couple of deep breaths though, I felt like I'd be back to normal in no time.
Can I get you a Panadol?
Oh,
oh, oh. A Nurofen Plus?
What do I do? What do I do?
You have to dance to release the pain, Amish.
Okay, can we dance then?
Jeez, I was going to be surprised if this helped.
Seems like a very strange directive from the doctor, isn't it? Just dance.
And evidently, it didn't.
Hang in there, buddy. Hang in there.
Because Haim soon commenced what we now know as the six stages of sting pain.
Shrieking.
Refusal to dance.
You have to dance.
I don't want to dance. I want to... This is the last time I've ever felt like dancing.
Screaming slash and or swearing.
Sweating.
Some shaking.
Biting stick requests. Problem was, this went on for an hour, relentlessly.
Cold water?
Yeah.
How's that?
I need ice.
Yeah, I'll get you ice. I'll get you ice.
Toxin from the ants generates the worst pain a human is capable of experiencing. There was nothing I could do to help him, so I essentially stood by in shock at the reaction.
That's just not stopping.
We later found out that not only do these ants sting multiple times a second, but they release a pheromone telling any nearby ants to also sting.
Oh, dear.
Haim had been stung 100 times over.
Can I lie down?
By the two-hour mark,
yeah.
Hamish had collapsed with exhaustion, but it was clear the pain hadn't receded at all. And the doctor offered up a suggestion.
Let's go to a hospital.
Well, a bit of a worrywart there, Doc, if you ask me.
Obligado.
No, seriously, thank you, though.
We made the hour-long trip back to the closest hospital where luckily the emergency doctors were able to treat Haim and I was able to find a seat.
Hola.
Good one not to get. Thank you, Chief.
8 hours after the stinging, I was finally able to talk to my friend again.
How are you feeling?
I think I prefer being stung by this big white wasp.
Morphine?
Yeah, he's a good wasp. That was unbelievable.
You look a lot like a man now, though, just so you know.
I grew an extra testicle.
The good news is, even though they felt like they'd been busted up by hammers, at midnight, I was able to get out of hospital and take my hands to Macca's.
All right, so that was the very basics of Hymenoptera. Really, we're just scratching the surface here, even barely. You could go for years studying these organisms. They're fascinating. I highly recommend you do it. If you get the chance, take the honeybee class, take any ant classes you can. Really, really amazing stuff. Let me know if you have any questions.